Hey, so I thought I'd talk a little bit about why Doom is the way it is, what things are going to the origin of it, and how we did things. So a lot of people know that the way we did some of the models was we had this rotating turntable with eight spots on it would click to, and we built latex, the Doom team before I even joined the team, built latex and metal armatures to put the creatures in there, and then they would film it in all eight directions and scan in the film, and then then they would pose it, change the pose, and film it all eight directions, scan it in. So it was kind of stop motion in a sense, because of course all the creatures in original Doom are actually sprites, and the size of the sprite was, you know, the more, you know, all the eight directions, all the animations. Now, some of the things we couldn't do with the armatures, like the death animation, so the artist just had to, like, make those and out of whole cloth, you know. And if an animation, for example, couldn't open its mouth, they would have to draw the mouth open, that kind of thing. So not every creature got to have an armature, but a lot of them did. I do not recall there being an imp, for example, but there was certainly a Baron of Hell and a Spider Mastermind and a Cyber Demon. The Cyber Demon was actually awkward to make. Remember, this is back in the days of 640K memory and like 386s and pretty primitive computers. And so the problem with the Cyber Demon was that he was asymmetrical. See, one leg and one arm were different from the other. So when the artists were doing the other monsters, they could just swap left for right for everything. But with the Cyber Demon, when it's walking to the left, you have to have a completely different sprite series than when he's walking to the right. So that was quite the thing. A lot of people don't realize what a big deal it was to finally be able to have 3D things moving around and doing things in the world. Just before we did Doom, for example, well, a couple years before we did Doom, I was working on the game Hyperspace, in which I had actual 3D spaceships, hyperspeed, or moving through space and light speed, moving through space and fighting. And these, we had a limit of like 30 or 40 polygons per figure, so it wasn't very many. By the time we got up to Quake and we actually had real 3D figures, I think the Hell Knight, not the Hell Knight, the Doom, the first knight you meet, the skinny kind of brown bronze one, he is like, I think, 90 polygons, you know, and the Hell Knight is like 125, so we were very limited on our ability to show things. Anyway, those are the models. We had models for things in Doom 1 that didn't make it into Doom 1. We didn't get the Mancubus and the Revenant both in Doom 1, the models, but they didn't get made into Doom 2. We also didn't have a model that I recall for the Cacodemon. It really didn't need it because it didn't have walk animations. It just moved around, and of course it had to open its mouth to shoot and it died. But like I said, we had death animations. We didn't have that as part of the model. We just had walking and like that. So my memory of the original Doom is that I did the original start area. John Romero has recently informed me that he had already done a start area before I did mine, and that the plan was always that he would do the original start area, which, you know, is fine. So I guess either I didn't remember that he already had one, or more likely, when I was there, I didn't know that they already had one, because I know he said he'd been working on it for quite a while before I joined on, so I simply might not have seen that start area because the start area is the introduction to the game. It's got to have all the cool stuff. Now my memory is that I went to John Carmack and showed my start area, and he said, "Oh no, we have to use the skybox. I know how to do a skybox now. We gotta have to show the sky in the first level." Now, and so my understanding was that my level, since I had other things to do, John simply did a new level with the skybox, but apparently what John says is that he already have it. Carmack wasn't telling me that I had to redo it or it had to be redone. He was just telling me that mine was unsuitable for that, probably among other reasons. Anyway, John Romero did the E1. Now, I'm usually credited with doing 20 of the 27 levels. I did some work on E1 M4, and I did some work on E1 M8. These were also worked on by E1 M4 was also worked on by Tom Hall, and both of them were worked on and reworked by John Romero. So I guess we can share some credit there if we want. Now, some of the levels I did, 8 of them, in fact, were reworked Tom Hall levels. He'd already done these before I came on, but they took a lot of time for me to rework. Really, Tom Hall's levels, and I'm not, this is not a dig on Tom, it's just like, it's how it was. He didn't have very many textures to put in the levels. He didn't have all the monsters. He didn't have all the items or what, you know, I had to lay a lot of those things into him. He didn't have decorations for the walls. I mean, how could he? They hadn't been built yet. So I had to do all that for his levels and take a lot of time. And typically what would happen is on one of Tom Hall's levels, he'd have one or two places that he kind of had been working on as a showpiece, you know, to look really good. And then the rest of it was more sketchy because he hadn't completed it. So then I went in and I not work so much on the showpiece areas, right? But I would work on the rest of it. And also I would make adjustments because, of course, we started playing the game. I think when Tom was there, I'm not sure if he even had deathmatch working very well yet. So we had put in deathmatch, put in the monsters. And so a lot of the areas had to change around for that. I had to put lots of stairs and traps and stuff. For example, in E2, M3, I think that's the one, the warehouse level, so to have more action in the warehouse. Anyway, lots of stuff. So Tom Hall's levels took me quite a while to rework, and so I regard them as mine as much as Tom, but I'm still grateful for Tom's contribution. Now, there's some things we stopped doing so much. We started early on doing them because we thought they were cool, and then later on we decided they were kind of a waste of time. So one of the things is that we didn't have light sources in original Doom, of course. We just had light ambiance. We'd say, this area is this lit, and this is this lit. But Tom, wanting to have the game look cool and stark and have some chiaroscuro, would draw in shadows on the floor, and the way he would do it, he would have like a pillar, and then he put an area behind the pillar that looked like shaped like a shadow, and he put a different light intensity in there, so it was darker, so it looked like a shadow. And he did a number of those, and they looked kind of cool, but as we played them, we noticed players didn't spend a lot of time looking at those. They had better things to do, like not be killed by the monsters, so we didn't do the shadows so much anymore. Another thing that we did, like very early on, John Carmack demanded that we have an imp up high in the opening level, so when he shot, the fireballs would arc down, because arcing down looked cool and it showed his game was really 3D. And we had a lot of that early on, and then we stopped. We still had monsters up high later in the game, but not to show off the 3D, because we figured there's enough chance to see that, just in case that was an interesting place to put them. So we didn't focus on that kind of thing. So when I was there, John Romero, obviously he did 7 to 9 of the levels, depending on how you count them. And I did most of the levels, though I wasn't there as long, but that's not because Romero was slacking off. He wasn't at all. Early on, I assume he was doing some work on the engine. And later on, what he was doing is he was working on DoomEd, which is what we called our editor for the game, which both he and I built all the levels using DoomEd. So I would go into John's office and say, hey, I need an area that will raise, that will go all the way down and crush you and then go back up and stop until you do a trigger or whatever the thing is I wanted. And then he would make that, you know, that thing. Then often he would use them too. And, some of the things we didn't use very often. There's one of the triggers that we had early on in the game was for a door that would be open at the start of the game. And then after 30 seconds, it would close and it would never open again. John Carmack thought that would be a cool thing to have for some reason. So if you're really fast, you can go and get that secret, but otherwise you couldn't. So we used that once, and then it was kind of like, you know, it's kind of make the guy run around at the start for a little bit. It didn't seem that cool, so we stopped using that. But John Romero spent a lot of time working on the deathmatch to make it good, and did a stellar work. And he actually, at one point, was starting to build our first deathmatch levels. We didn't get those in Doom 1, obviously. And then when the game was getting near complete, because we were playing a lot of deathmatch, we started to go back into our levels and make changes in them for deathmatch, to like little portals where you could look in and see someone and blast him, or spots where you could see something else cool, just like, you know, little deathmatch thingies, you know. So one thing that happened in the game that was interesting is that a lot of you may know that when Doom first came out, it had super terrible multiplayer. The deathmatch stuff was really awful. And the reason it was, technically, was because what it did is it spammed a number of, I'm not sure exactly how it worked, I used, but it spammed a number of packets that became astronomically more with the number of people that were playing deathmatch. So that if you were on like on our network at, in software, there was no problem. You could play deathmatch all you wanted. There was like, four of us playing deathmatch at a time, you know, usually typically, sometimes a couple more. But if you were on a college campus, which had hundreds of computers, then it would spam to all the computers. And so what happened is it really rapidly would, or if you're a big corporation, it would really rapidly shut down and destroy your network. And so we got banned almost immediately everywhere. Now, the reason our deathmatch was so bad was because before the game was out, John Carmack, who didn't want to write the networking code, he had better things to do. We'd talked to this guy in, I think, California, and contracted with him to do the networking code. And the programmers liked him, and they thought he was going to do a good job. And they said, and then when you finish doing the networking code, you can come and you can work and be part of id Software. Because he said, I can't leave my job right now. I got to stay here. But the job knows I'm working for you, he said. My employers know, and they know that I'm leaving when it's over. So 2 weeks before we wanted to release Doom, which was in December, we like called the guy and say, where's our network code? And got in touch with his boss, and the boss laughed at us, and he said, "Oh yeah, this guy, can't remember his name just as well, said, oh no, he's a pathological liar, and he was never going to leave here. We didn't know he'd told you he was going to work for you, but he has done nothing. He just took your check and cashed it, and did nothing, and he's not going to be there." So there we were, 2 weeks before Doom was going to release, with no deathmatch code. Now, something important to keep in mind is that we didn't think deathmatch was going to be a big thing. Up until that point, there was very few people that were playing head-to-head with their modems. That's what we had, modems, right? In fact, before I came to id Software, I had worked with Dan Bunton on a game called Command HQ, which was primarily intended to play head-to-head, and it was actually one of the first RTS games. I mean, you played head-to-head, you had armies, you tried to conquer, you had hidden areas, there was all this stuff in it. And Danielle's theory was that since 65% of all people had modems, and probably gamers are among them, it should be possible to sell a game that went head-to-head and multiplayer. But Command HQ didn't sell that well. Maybe that wasn't, I don't think it was the game's fault. I think it was maybe people weren't ready for a head-to-head game. Also, MicroProse software had, you know, was kind of on its last legs at the time as far as its management was concerned. So anyway, that flopped. So we thought that Doom, so that my experience was that head-to-head gaming doesn't do. And the other guys at id said, yeah, head-to-head won't work. But we wanted to put in the deathmatch, not because we thought it was going to be this giant, huge hit, but because it was super fun and we liked it. We thought there'd be enough other people that would like it too, that it would be worth putting in. So we really wanted to have it. Anyway, so John Carmack said in there, 2 weeks before the release, we have to have networking code, we all thought. So he quick cobbled something together as fast as he could, and we tested it, and it worked on our system. And so really, the fact that it's not so much that the multiplayer is broken, it's that a genius programmer only had like a few days to make something that would work in a field that wasn't really his expertise. Math, 3D, John's great. He hadn't done that much networking stuff up to then, so he just did what he could. And really, you can argue he did a stellar job, but the result was that within a few months, we got someone else, well, I don't remember someone else, we did good networking code and put it out there, and then that fixed, you know, the problems. And then that led to other people playing head-to-head, and now it's like almost required. So that was it. So one of the other things I did besides designing levels is I did a lot of the single-player playtesting on Doom 1. I would estimate that I did like 90% of it. I was playing all the games constantly through. And I want you to know that the way I played the games, because you had to be able to beat them, starting with just a pistol in case you got killed, because who knows if you're going to load and save the game. Every single level in Doom 1, up to the hardest level, not Nightmare, but the one before that, I played starting with just a pistol. So they're all designed to play with just a pistol. to be able to win with just a pistol. And then we released it, and the hardest mode proved was beaten by everyone within a few weeks. Then we went back and made an even harder mode. Of course, they beat that too, but then we just gave up and turned out the towel. So I joined id Software after the engine was pretty much complete, but before a lot of the details were complete. Not all the monsters worked. There were the items that didn't work. There was decorations weren't up yet. Not all the weapons were figured out. Ammo, names of the things, textures, working triggers. Now, to John Carmack, all that was cosmetic. What he cared about was the 3D, and rightly so. So all the other stuff had to be done by the artists, Adrian and Kevin, by John Romero, by me. I didn't do textures, but I named things and I designed stuff. So we all were doing that together. Now, something else to consider is that when you look at the list of people who do a modern game, you're going to see a million billion people. Okay. But our entire dev team at id Software was about six people at any given time, divided up about equally between programmers, designers, and artists, about two of each. Now, there's kind of a blurred line when it comes to John Romero, because he both programmed and did design, so he had a foot in both camps. But six of us did Doom. So that, I think, is a pretty stellar thing. Now, there was more people at id than six people, but they weren't all developers. So Donna worked the front desk, Jay Wilbur did business stuff, and Sean Green did the customer service and other help, QA. So we had Sean Green wore a lot of hats. So anyway, that's what's going on with Doom 1. So let's talk a little bit about Doom 2. First, one of the cool things about Doom 2 is we added American McGee to our team. Now, American McGee was a friend. He lived in the same housing complex as John Carmack, along with another guy. And they came over and joined us. And American McGee did something that was totally not illegal, but that made a former roommate really mad. And so he briefly had a death threat, which was exciting for him, I guess. The death threat, nothing ever came of it, but he hid in the office for a couple days under the threat of that. I mean, I would have been terrified. We had another death threat after Doom 1. A crazy guy sent all of id a letter saying that we were Satanists and he was going to come kill us. So we actually contacted the police in the town the guy mailed from, and it turned out he was a guy who was just off his meds, and they put him back on the meds and nothing ever came of it. So Doom 2, I want to talk about some of the things I did on Doom 2. It was my idea to do the Arachnotron. Now, one of the deals in Doom 1 is that the Cyber Demon appears in the second episode at the end, and he's like the greatest boss ever. And then at the end of the third episode, there's the Spider Mastermind. And I wanted to put him at the end of the third episode because I thought he looked really cool. And if you play the Spider Mastermind level starting with a pistol, he's really hard. But of course, no one ever does. By the time you get to him, you got rocket launchers and BFGs, and so you just blow everything up. So the Spider Mastermind doesn't have a chance. But I didn't realize that since I played everything starting with a pistol. Anyway, I still thought he looked really cool. And so I convinced the artist into making me a little Spider Mastermind. And that was the Arachnotron. That way I could have more Spider Masterminds and it would be cool. And then later on, I started using Spider Masterminds to play. I'd find big areas to put them in Doom 2 and I'd give them babies and it was, you know, that kind of thing. So the other thing is I kept wanting to have more and more creatures. I always liked a variety of monsters, but time was short. Doom 2 had to be done in less than a year, and everything had to be, so there wasn't a lot of time on it, right? So one idea I had to speed things up was the Pain Elemental. Now, the Pain Elemental, he's the kind of beige blob that has two little arms. The reason he was easy to do is because he was a floating ball like the Cacodemon. See? And the Cacodemon, because he was a floating ball, was super easy to animate. He didn't have a walk animation. He just moved around and his fire would open his mouth. So the Pain Elemental was the same way, though. It had two little arms, didn't really do anything. He didn't walk on him or anything. So the Pain Elemental was really easy for the artist to do, and that's where that came from. Oh, you know what? And speaking of the Pain Elemental, as you probably know, it shoots lost souls out of his mouth. So the lost souls, so my original plan, so originally the lost souls were little horned skulls with a green glow around them. And I thought, oh, so we'll design the lost souls so they'll sit back in the distance and they'll like snipe you. they'll go, and you'll take damage from them, like a bullet, you know, and then you'll have to go fight the Lost Souls, and it'd be cool. And that was my idea for them, and it wasn't really that cool, you're probably thinking in the back of your head. What happened is that Adrian Carmack said, what if instead the Lost Souls come screaming through the air like a rocket and slam into you and they're on fire? And that was so much better than my idea that we immediately switched over to that. And that's where the Lost Souls come from that you know and love now. And of course, when we were first fighting it, like, they would kill us a lot if we had a rocket launcher, because they'd charge for us and we fired the rocket launcher, it would go up in our face and then we die. So the pain elemental making rocket launchers was cool. And then I also, another thing I wanted to do is I liked the art for the Hell Baron. The Hell Baron was pretty cool. He was the boss of the first episode of Doom, of course. But the problem with the Hell Baron was that he was kind of boring to kill because he had 1,000 hit points. So you had to, like, bang, 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 until you finally got him to go down. It was kind of tedious. It'd be more interesting if you'd have less hit points and you could have more of them. In other words, he couldn't dish it out, but he could sure take it. So what we did, I said, let's make the Hell Knight. And the Hell Knight was exactly the Hell Baron with half as many hit points. Just like that. And a slight change in his texture color, so it was trivial for the artist to make. So now we had a monster that I could put multiple ones of on a level, and they could fight you, and it didn't take forever to kill them if you had to, but if they attacked you from behind or something, they were still dangerous. So that's where the Hell Knight come from. On to the Mancubus. By the way, I named all these monsters, so, just, you know, they had the monsters, they didn't know what to call them, so I named him. Oh, and the Spectre in Doom 1, that was totally John Carmack's idea. He said, why don't we make it a demon that's invisible? And he didn't want to make it a demon that was ranged, that was invisible, because that might be problematic. So he took the big pink demons that we had and just said, I'll just put a texture on it that's almost invisible, and then we'll have a cool invisible monster. So that's what he did. That's where it came from. Now you know. So the Mancubus is famous. He's the big fat guy with the two gun arms. He's famous for saying bad things about your mom. He goes, and everyone thinks he's talking about their mom. And the fact of the matter is that his sound is literally a sampling of a pig grunting. So unless the pig is talking about your mom, you're just reading things into what the Mancubus said. So now you know. The Mancubus isn't talking about your mom. He's just a pig. So Bobby Prince told me that. So next, we will discuss what was going on with the levels in Doom 2. And Doom 2, one of the things we needed, because he had to get it done so fast, and John Romero didn't have to make Doomed. I mean, John Romero was still doing stuff on Doomed for new triggers, but he wasn't doing as much programming, so he could spend a lot more time making levels. And so there was four of us doing the levels. There was me, Sean Green made a couple, American McGee, who joined partway through and was pretty good at making levels, and then John Romero, of course, is great. So there was 32 levels. I did 17 of them, but two of them were actually the Wolfenstein levels, so they weren't, I mean, I still had to build them and do things in them, but they were not necessarily as cumbersome or complex as you might expect. So anyway, that's some stories about Doom 1 and Doom 2 and why they were that way and why they were odd. There's more stories I could tell, like how I came to make the downtown or the hated chasm map, but you know, it was just a bunch of us guys, six of us working hard, trying to make things be an effective game that would be fun and doing really well. So one thing you may want to know is that the original Doom, which is the one you had that you could get basically for free, that one sold like a fifth as much or a tenth as much as the game that you had to buy. So that kind of taught us our lesson about offering things for free and also helped put me on my path of hating all pirates. So there we are. Thank you for listening.